Hello?
Yes.
And
then, perfect. Okay.
And I'll follow you for the first couple seconds just to make sure that everything is okay. And
perfect. Thank you. So your name is? Your name
Marco.
Is Marco. Good. Thank you, Marco.
Okay. Hi, Marco. Can we get started?
Yes, buddy.
Hello? Okay, very good. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the ICTP's Salam Distinguished Lecture Series for the year 2023. As you know, this is an important event on the academic calendar of ICTP. It has been a tradition now for over 10 years, and many very distinguished scientists have come and lectured at ICTP on very diverse topics. And the idea is precisely to make the latest developments in diverse fields of science accessible to the ICTP scientific community. And we are very happy that this year we have Professor Sandu Popescu. Okay, so this lecture series is supported by the Kuwait Foundation for the Advancement of Sciences. KFAS, and KFAS and ICTP have extended their long-time partnership for science advancement by creating a new joint program of support for scientists from Kuwait and other Arab countries to be engaged in ICTP activities. In addition, KFAS offers support for 3 Arab students to attend their postgraduate diploma course at ICTP and postdoctoral fellowship to young postdoctoral Arab scientists to continue research in the areas of expertise of ICTP. So we are very, very thankful to KFAS for our collaboration, which has made this important lecture series possible at ICTP. Let me say a few words about Professor Popescu. He's a theoretical physicist from the University of Bristol. His main field of research centers on the conceptual and fundamental aspects of quantum physics, which is the topic of this lecture series. He is a pioneer in quantum information, best known for his work on entanglement and associated phenomena of non-locality, which are crucial for our understanding of quantum theory. And as you know, the recent Nobel Prize was also in this field, in this area. He has worked, so it has a long and distinguished history going back many, many years, almost to the beginning of quantum mechanics. He has also worked on many other aspects of quantum theory, ranging from very fundamental experiments, such as the first quantum teleportation experiment, which was one of the landmark experiments in quantum information theory, to even patentable commercial applications. So he has a breadth of view. And another of his interests is the foundations of statistical mechanics. And more recently, his interest has been in the thermodynamics of quantum systems. So we are very happy to have somebody like Sandu Popescu to tell us about these very exciting developments at the frontiers of science. He has, of course, won numerous awards. I will just name a couple. In 2017, he was elected the Fellow of the Royal Society. In 2016, he received the Dirac Medal. not the ICTP Dirac Medal, but equally prestigious Dirac Medal from the Institute of Physics, and many other important awards. He will be giving three lectures on topics related to fundamental aspects of quantum physics. Today, he will be talking about the smallest possible thermal machines and the foundations of thermodynamics. Tomorrow, he will talk about quantum non-locality and beyond at the same time. And on Friday, he will talk about, at 11 o'clock, multiple time states and the flow of time in quantum mechanics. So these are all very interesting and important topics. I just to remind you, usually we hold this series in the week of Salam's birthday, which is on the 29th January, and which falls this year on a Sunday, so we are having it a little bit ahead of time. So on the last day, we will also announce the recipients of the 2023 Spirit of Salam Award, which recognizes those who, like Salam himself, have worked tirelessly to promote the development of science and technology around the world with this specific mission to make science available to all. So that will be announced on Friday, just before the Friday lecture. Just to remind you that there will be refreshments after the talk in the lobby. And as is the custom at ICTP, the diploma students are requested to have the opportunity to stay on after the talk today to meet with the speaker. And the idea is to promote so that they can ask freely questions. Everybody else leaves and only the students can interact with the colloquium speaker for about half an hour. And refreshments will be saved for them, even if they talk for a bit longer. So I'm really looking forward to it. I was also very happy that Sandu, in fact, mentioned, and I hope he's going to do it. He indicated his preference to give a Blackboard talk, which is really how we had envisioned the Salam lectures, so that it's really the involvement of the audience is easier on a Blackboard talk. And I was hoping to be there in person, but unfortunately I'm down with flu, so I will have to watch it on Zoom. So I'm looking forward to this talk. The session will be moderated by Professor Rosario Fazio. Afterwards, the question and answer session. Okay, thank you very much. It's over to you, Professor Popescu.
Well, first of all, hello everybody, and well, if Atish still hears me, I wish him all the best and quick getting better from the flu. So I'm really honored to be here in this place that over so many years have done so much to spread educations about physics throughout the world. So it is really one of the, well, probably it was one of the first, and now fortunately one of the many places that are doing this, which is a very, very useful thing to do. So as I was thinking what to do, I thought that three lectures give me a lot of opportunity, but it gave me two different types of opportunities. One of them is to have an interesting subject and have time at leisure to develop it. The other was to give you some introductions in some of the things that I believe are very, very interesting at the moment, and then give you the opportunity to look further. So I decided for the latter. So I will give you three talks that are all of them different, at least apparently, although at the deep level they all contain the same basic idea, that is an inquiry in the foundations of quantum mechanics. Now, I don't want to disappoint, but the first lecture, well, I already had prepared, so it will be on PowerPoint. The other two, I will use these blackboards that are wonderful. So today I will talk about the smallest possible thermal machines and the foundations of thermodynamics. So the whole idea came when one of my friends, Hans Briegel, visited me many years ago. And at that time, he was interested in the issue of whether or not there could exist non-trivial quantum effects in biological systems. So see, already when people started quantum information and quantum computation, immediately, the hope was, since quantum computers can work so much better than classical ones, that perhaps our brains could do something like that. Well, this was a bit far-fetched thing, but at least it opened the question that perhaps there are non-trivial effects, quantum effects in biological systems. I insist on the word non-trivial because obviously everything follows the laws of quantum mechanics. But, every atom is quantum mechanically, but then every piece of stone has quantum effects. So we're not talking about that. It was more interesting to talk about non-trivial effects in these systems, effects on a larger scale than you would expect. So people generally dismiss this idea. And the reason why they dismissed is because many of the quantum effects get very easily washed out by noise. And people, in order to see quantum effects, they have to work very, very hard in laboratories to isolate the system, to maintain coherence, and so on. And people believe that coherence will be lost immediately the moment you go to anything slightly larger than a small molecule. However, we realized that, in fact, all these intuitions were based more or less on the idea that you perturb the system and the system comes back to equilibrium. But living beings are systems that are not at equilibrium. In fact, I don't want to reach thermal equilibrium anytime soon. So they are open systems, open, driven systems far from equilibrium. So with these motivations, we try to think of all kinds of possible effects. So because they are open and driven systems far from equilibrium, by the way, how do we know about this? We know that, for example, when an organism would die, suddenly will start decomposing. It means that there are always forces that will try to destroy it. But the fact that the organism survives is because it's doing repairing all the time. If you wish, this is like error correction. Error correction that goes on all the time. Now, one of the things that we asked, knowing that our colleagues try to cool down the system to maintain coherence, was, could biological molecules act, for example, as refrigerators? So, you see, the fact that a biological organism can cool itself is obvious. You go to the beach in the middle of the summer, temperature is well above 36 degrees, and nevertheless, your body maintains the temperature. Then you could think, that is at the scale of the full body. But you may think that different organs in the body may have different temperature. Your liver might be warmer than 36. Your brain needs to be a little bit cooler. The question is, could we have this effect when we go down to the scale of molecules, say the scale of proteins? Because all the chemical reactions that take place in an organism are very, very dependent on the temperature. If your body reaches 43 degrees, that's the end of it. the all the chemical reactions going on go wrong, and then the body cannot survive. So could, for example, a molecule, say a protein, act as a refrigerator? That was one of our questions. So getting back to this, to the motivation, what do you do when you ask a question like this? So I was very enthusiastic. And of course, immediately I made a very big discovery. Not about science, but about myself. The fact that I know nothing about proteins. Well, very little, let's say. So then, what do you do in a situation like this? Well, obviously, a way to approach it, you go to the library, or you go on the internet, get a good book on proteins, start learning about it, and hope for the best. Well, we didn't do that. So there is another way, which is forget about it. Really forget about it. Well, almost. And go back to the things that you know. It is always good to know a few really basic things. So the things that I knew, well, I knew a little bit about qubits, about quantum systems with two states. So then I asked myself, forget the biology. Suppose that I would like to build, say, a refrigerator. Could I build a refrigerator from a few quantum bits, from a few systems with two states? This is interesting because, you know, then you could use them in a quantum computer to refrigerate part, to stabilize, and things like this. But more important, it is a question of foundations of physics. So our first question was, yeah, I want something small, like a few qubits or something like that. But when you ask this, you say, okay, if I'm going to go small, let me go to the smallest. Let me ask, what is the smallest possible thermal machine? And this may seem to you that you impose further constraints on yourself, trying not to just build something small, but to build the smallest possible. Well, actually, if you are just in the business of engineering and you want to optimize something, that is indeed hard. But the moment you reach down to really fundamental things, then the more you can simplify, the easier the task is, actually. So this is the question that we ask. What are the smallest possible thermal machines? Now, there are some things that one needs to see here. First of all, how do you define that something is small? Okay, smaller. But it can be smaller as volume, or smaller as mass, or smaller as linear dimension. What do you want? Well, actually, quantum mechanics gives something very basic. In quantum mechanics, I can look at the number of states, because systems are quantified. So the particular question we ask, what to make thermal machine with the smallest number of quantum states. Other issues. Well, you know, whenever you ask a fundamental question, you realize that there were some issues that whenever you thought, you know, in general terms, you were not aware. So what we want here, first of all, is that they should be self-contained. What do I mean by this? First of all, that there should be no external source of work. So your refrigerator at home, you plug it to the mains. But you get some electric current, but that is produced in, I don't know, some power station. So your refrigerator uses the power station as well. You should count that. So you should be a good accountant if you start looking at this. So we do not allow any external source of work. Or for example, people doing optics, they cool atoms every single day. That is their business, but they use a laser in order to do that. So you need to calculate the degrees of freedom of the laser. And then there are trickier things. If you are a theoretician, you may want to use unitary transformations. But this means you want to have an entire time evolution, like the time evolution of a quantum gate. But that is a long process, what you want, and that needs to be controlled. When you start an interaction, when you finish an interaction. So you need control. That you should also count. So we do not allow that. We would like things to evolve under their own Hamiltonian. Okay, so these are the few sort of questions that we would ask. How to construct these very small machines? What is the minimal size? How well do they work? And is there a complementarity between size and efficiency? Okay, so let me start after this very long introduction. Right, so I also didn't know too much about thermal machines, but I knew one thing, which is this Feynman's example. So in Feynman's example, he has a box with an ideal gas in it. And in the box, there is a wheel, a pedal wheel, that molecules may come and hit it. So the idea is we would like this wheel to turn, because if I can turn a wheel, I can then hook a string to the wheel, put a weight, and I will lift the weight. But this example really doesn't work because molecules go all around in this thing. Some molecule may hit the pedal wheel and make it turn anti-clockwise. Another may hit the pedal wheel, make it clockwise. So this wheel will just oscillate here. And the weight will go up and will go down and up and down, and nothing gets done. Okay, so here is a way in which you may want to attempt to solve this problem. And that is the following. You have here this ratchet and pole arrangement, meaning you have another wheel with teeth, and these teeth are asymmetric. Then you have a spring here and a little stick. And the wheel is, this wheel with teeth is connected to your pedal wheel. So you encounter these sort of things anytime when you are in a building and there is a door that only moves one way to allow you to exit and not to come back in after hours. So what happens here? That the wheel turns, and if it turns clockwise, it just pushes the little stick up, and then the little stick falls behind it. If the wheel would like to move anti-clockwise, it cannot because it hits the little stick. That's all. So that means that in such an arrangement, you would hope now that whenever the pedal wheel is pushed anti-clockwise, it doesn't move. When it's pushed clockwise, it moves, and you are able to lift something and do work. Good idea, but it really doesn't work. It has a problem. And here's the problem. Imagine the tooth, imagine the little stick. The wheel goes normally, clockwise, the stick comes, falls behind it. But it doesn't stay there. It starts oscillating. Yes, it's just a harmonic oscillator, a stick on a spring. So after a few turns, now the stick starts oscillating so much that at a certain moment it goes higher up than the size of a tooth, and now the wheel can move anti-clockwise. Okay, but now you find out a way of doing it. All you need is to cool this movement. So you put your little stick in another box with an ideal gas at temperature T2 smaller than T1. So it cools down this vertical movement of the stick. So now the arrangement really works. Because now only movement of the ratchet clockwise will go. The stick is cooled, it stays down after every single tooth, and the wheel cannot move anti-clockwise. Now you can really put a string with a weight on it and it will be lifted. But there is a penalty here, because now not the entire energy that you will take from this box will go into turning the wheel and lifting a weight, because part of it is dissipated in the other box that needs to cool it. That is the important process here. So there are a few things to learn. First of all, that you really need two different temperature baths, and you need a constraint. The constraint between the little stick there and the wheel. When the stick is down, the wheel cannot go in one direction. Once you implement these constraints, they are at the basis of every single thermal machine that you want. Okay, so here's what we did. So here is, for the simplest or the smallest possible refrigerator, I wanted to also cool a very small system. So here I have a system, a two-state system, say an atom and two energy states, that is immersed here in a bath at temperature T1. So what happens in such a situation? Well, the system spends a lot of time on the ground state. Then, because of collision with external molecules in the bath, may get excited, comes out to the excited state, may disexcite and go down, and so on. So overall, it has some probability of being on the lower energy state, some smaller probability being in the higher one, corresponding to this temperature T1. To cool it means that you would like it to spend more time at the lower energy. So that is what you want to do. So here is one first design, which is bring next to it another system with exactly the same energy level difference. So put both of them at the same temperature, T1, and add an interaction. What is the interaction? The interaction is that it is possible for your system to go down in energy and push the energy up in this external qubit. So then you say, good, I've done it. Because now I open another channel for my system to lose energy. Previously, it could lose energy just to the molecules in the medium around it, but now it can give energy to the machine. Now, the bad thing is, well, I don't know whether it's bad. The bad for the designer of this thermal machine is that Hamiltonians are Hermitian. The fact that the Hamiltonian is Hermitian means that once you have this interaction, you also have the reverse one. Okay? If that would not be the case, nature will look completely different. But this is the basic fact about nature, is that all transformations, well, let me say transformation, there are different ways of saying transformation, conserving formation, and so on. But basically, that the Hamiltonians that drive the evolution have this property. Once a transformation is possible, the reverse is equally possible. All right, so it doesn't really work, because the green transformation cools the system, passing the energy to the machine, but then the machine goes down and reheats my system. So as I open the channel for the system to lose energy, I also open a new channel for my system to gain energy. So it's not a good idea. All right, but now that you understand this, here comes another idea. You see, what was here the thing is that the bad transition, which couples them, the red one, required my system to be ground and the other system to be hot, to be at the excited state. If I find a mechanism of removing my machine from the excited state, for example, taking this system by hand and moving it down, then there is nothing to push energy into my system. And I can do this if I put my machine at a lower temperature, T2, so it means that my machine interacting with its own environment will now be brought down to the ground state. And now this constraint will mean while I'm able to pass energy from the system to the machine is no longer there to give it back. Does it work? Yes, this works. It works perfectly. But it is not exactly what you wanted, because you see, this means that I have my machine at a lower temperature than the system that I want to cool. This is not a refrigerator. This is an ice cube that you plug into your drink. It works, but you need the ice cube to start with. But we already understand how all these constraints go. So once we understand, we go to the next one. So here's the next one. This is my system here. It is a system with two states, energy difference E1. My machine is built out of two other systems, each of them with two states. So for the time being, let me just put all of them at the same temperature and see what happens. I would like now to make a coupling between these three systems of the following way. The side systems, which is my system and this part of the machine, could both go down in energy and push the energy to the middle. Okay? That is the good one, because here also my system goes down in energy, accompanied by the third. The bad one is the red transition, which exists there because the Hamiltonian is Hermitian, in which the middle qubit goes down in energy and pushes up my system and this ancillary thing up. So that is the transition that I would like to suppress. Okay? How can I suppress it? Well, there are two ways actually to suppress. You see, the constraint for the bad transition, which is like this. This one goes down and these two go up. One way would be to remove the middle one from the excited state down. That again I can do if I put this intermediate one, not at temperature T1 as my system, but at a lower temperature. That was the ice cube. I don't want to do that. But I can prevent this triple thing, middle one going down, the sideways going up, if this one, the third, is not on the ground state. If it is not there, this transition will not occur. And I can do that if I take the temperature here to be larger than T1. So just by warming up a part, I'm able to implement this constraint so that only the green transition will take place and the red one will not. In general, what do I want here? Well, all I want, in fact, I can tinker with both temperatures of the middle one and of the side one. But that is the idea. I have these transitions from my system that is excited, ground, and the other one excited, so the two side ones going down and the middle one going up and backwards, and I want to make sure that this backward transition doesn't work. That means I will have a constraint on the populations. I want more population when the side ones are up and the middle is down, which will say that more times that will happen than the condition when the side ones are down and the middle one is up. So once I implement this condition, my refrigerator will work. You recognize the pieces, in fact. The pieces of this refrigerator are pretty simple. You see, what does it mean that I take energy from here? Remember, the side ones go down, and the middle one goes up. That will have to be, in the end, dissipated somewhere in its environment at temperature T2. Well, go to your refrigerator, put your hand behind it, and you'll feel it warm. That is the spiral behind your refrigerator. And it will have to be dissipated in the room. T3, well, if you go to, this one is the hotter, the hottest one. If you go to your refrigerator at home, you will not see that because it has an engine that compresses something. If, on the other hand, you had a very old refrigerator, you will see that all you need, it doesn't have any engine in it, just some arrangement with a gas that you can warm it up. And you just put a resistor that makes it hot, or you can put a flame there and it will work. So that is the one that drives the action. Here is where you, the energy is taken from there. It's also pushed out into the environment and on the way drags energy from your system from here. That is how it works. Okay, what else? What can we do? Well, this was a refrigerator. When I discussed about Feynman's example, I discussed about an engine that does work. Why did I go from that to a refrigerator? And the reason is very simple. It's because I was silly. You see, when I thought of this, I knew that work, the difference between work and heat, is that work is delivering energy in an organized way, while heat is delivering it into a disorganized way. But when you go to small systems, what is organized and what is disorganized, you know, you don't know the difference. So it's very difficult to define what is work when you go down to small systems. And that was what I wanted to avoid. Why was I silly? Because nobody told me that the system must be small. The system could be big. I wanted the engine to be small. But you know, whenever you discover something, you always discover it into a more complicated way, and then you simplify. So, nevertheless, this opens the question of what is work at that level. So what is work? Well, if you would look in papers discussing about work for quantum systems, you would see a large range of definitions for it, just because people had to somehow try to understand the difference between transfer of energy in an organized form or a disorganized form. So it was good that I didn't know about any of these papers, because then I would have been, confused by them. Sometimes it's good not to know too much, because you could then think for yourself. Otherwise, you need a supplementary effort to try to throw away many things before starting to think. So I try to do the simplest thing. We know that we do work if we are able to lift a weight. Oh, that's very simple. So all I need is a machine that has two thermal baths, a hot one, TH, a cold one, TC, and a weight. If I succeed to lift the weight, I'm done. My machine is doing work. So here is how I implement it. My system, which previously I took a system with two levels, is now a system with many levels. Like this weight that actually goes from down to up, and it just goes and goes. So let me take something like a harmonic oscillator, a system with many energy states. And all I want a machine that will take this system and push it up, 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 up. Okay, so what is my machine? Well, exactly as it was before. My machine is made out of the same two qubits, two systems, each of them with two energy levels, with exactly the same interaction as I did in the case of the refrigerator. The side ones go down, the middle one goes up, or the middle one goes down and the sideways go up. Why is this not a refrigerator? Because I run it into a different regime. Now I want the middle one to go down to push the side ones up. So I want to put more energy into the middle one. Previously, I put more energy into the side one. So that's all. I let the system go, and now these two parts of the system, T2 and T3, I drag energy from T2. Some energy is passed into T3 and it's in its environment, and my system will go up. Exactly the same principle as before, which all I need that the probability that that the middle one is excited should be larger than the probability that the side one is excited. That's all. So that would mean that if I look at the Boltzmannian distribution, E2 minus E2 over KT2 must be larger than E2 minus E3 over KT3. So basically, all I need in this case is T2 larger than T3. It will always work. Okay, so I built my machines. What else? Once you have them, you start asking questions. How good is a machine like this? How efficient it is? Now, if you still remember your thermodynamics, or in fact, this is what I discussed in Feynman's example, you see that you cannot transfer all the energy from the hot gas into lifting the weight, you need to dissipate part of it to cool that little stick. The interesting thing that I did not tell you at that moment is that by doing better engineering, you cannot decrease as much as you want this transfer. There is a finite amount of energy that needs to be dissipated. Sorry. That is the great result of Carnot. So even the most efficient machine will need to waste some energy. That is one of the basic laws of thermodynamics and everything that goes with it. The fact that we are aging, the fact that things are becoming more and more disorganized in the universe and so on, follow from that. But then you add, okay, so suppose you have the best designed system and it reaches the Carnot efficiency. Now, it doesn't mean that every engine reaches that thing. Of course, you can do a bad design. And in fact, almost always you do a bad design. So you are very far from reaching even that goal of the Carnot thing. Now, sometimes you may do a bad design simply because, you are silly and you don't know how to do a good design. Well, people that design refrigerators or machines are not silly, but they are grappling with other problems. The type of materials they have, you cannot have everything done at perfection. Here, there is a third thing. If I want the smallest machine, I put to myself some supplementary constraints. I cannot design any machine I want. I really want a small one. So one question is, are these things efficient? A normal machine, like the machine that Sadi Carnot imagined that reaches the maximum efficiency, it's a classical thing. It goes to an infinite number of states. If I only allow my machine to have four different states, how well can I do it? It is conceivable that my machine will not work so well because, and we are used in quantum mechanics, there are all these complementarity relations. For example, you can measure position but not momentum. And if you measure position better, you lose your information about momentum, and vice versa. So there is always, in many instances in quantum mechanics, there is a trade-off. So is here a trade-off? That when I increase the number of states, I can get with my efficiency, you know, better and better. And when I decrease my number of states, my efficiency will become worse and will hit a limit. This is very natural to be so. Very natural, but the question, what is it in reality? Well, what is it in reality? That's a good question. First, let me tell you what is this system. That is the best system. The best system, you would imagine that you take something from the hot bath, you take some quantity of heat, Q, you will do some work, W, and you will dump into the cold one some quantity of heat, QC. And what it was discovered is that the ratio between the work and the energy that you take from the hot bath is not one, but it is one minus the ratios of the temperature. So that is the thing that you aim for. So how well can we do? How much is it degraded? Does it degrade when the number of states becomes small? And the answer is no. Surprising as it is, even if you restrict the number of states, the design can go towards the extreme. You can do a machine that it is as good as possible, even if you are forced to do the simplest possible machine, which already tells you a basic thing about nature, that the simplest thermal machine can reach the maximum efficiency. Now, actually, the example is so easy that I can give the proof in such a short talk. And it goes like this. You see, the design constraint, this is the only design constraint, is that the energy difference between two of these levels, E1, plus the energy difference here, E3, equals E2. That is the basic constraint, apart from the fact that here I have two-state system. When is a system at maximum efficiency? Well, this was known already in classical thermodynamics. You really have to drive things slowly. You don't want to mess up with the thing. If you have a piston, you don't want to create shock waves if you move the piston too fast. And everything has to run very smoothly. And in fact, in such a situation, you are as likely to go one way as you are likely to go the other way. Ideally, when you hit Carnot limit, in fact, nothing gets done. You are the most efficient when you do nothing. But you need to wait. Okay, that is the extreme procrastination. So you have to make this machine to be so, you know, moving one way, the other way, which simply means that the population of being here and the other one down must be equal with the population of being this one up and that one down, because those populations are the thing that drive the machine. So all it means is that these two functions, E2 minus E3 over KT3, must be equal to E2 minus E2 over KT2, because they tell me about the populations of driving one way, driving the other way. This expression I can simplify because all I need is the exponents to be the same. So E3 over T3 must be equal E2 over T2. That's all. Now, there is something else that you learn. This tells me what are the design requirements on the energy levels. They don't tell me how much work I do. That depends of how many transitions occur per unit of time. That depends of everything else. How well I couple the systems to their own environment, how strong is the coupling in between them, and so on. But all I know that when one system goes down, this goes up and that goes up. Things come in pieces. So the ratio of heat and work is the same as the ratio of the energy separation, because that is the value of one piece that is transferred at that time. So the ratio between work Q2 and Q3 is the one, is the ratio of the energies. And you do a little bit of algebra here just to divide things. And you find out that actually your system can reach the Carnot efficiency. Okay. Given this, let me go back and ask, what really is work? I know now how I can do a machine. I know that this machine is efficient, so this machine can be used as a basis for defining what work is. So let me look more carefully into it. This is my machine that takes me the system up, 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 up. But let me just focus on two energy levels. What would happen if I would only have two of them, like this? Well, what happens is that when my machine is running, it just pushes this middle system higher up. How much? Well, it will have to push it towards the upper level. So it will produce inversion. Now, if you think of that now, it's something very simple. Up to now, you were thinking that work is to put something organized. But here is an example. I take this and I lift it. So originally it was at ground state and zero probability at the higher state. Now it is at the upper state and not down. I created a population inversion. So here's the thing. Until now, you knew about work as being one of the basic things in physics. You learn the very first year when you really start learning physics. On the other hand, population inversion is some, you know, tiny effect. People dealing with lasers deal with it, but you don't really encounter in many other things. And what we claim is that work and creation population inversion is one and the same thing. You really create, what means doing work is doing a population inversion. Okay. So in the end, when you start building this, you start building from some funny motivation, and the signature that you get something interesting is that it allows you to ask questions that you would have never thought of them before, in direction that you never thought before. So with all this machinery, let me ask, what do thermal machines actually do? So here is my thermal machine. This is the system, and this is the machine. The machine has two pieces, two qubits, two-level systems. And let me look at the interaction. So the interaction is like this. It takes ground state, excited and ground, two down, one up, into the middle one going down, the side one going up, into EGE. So let me look at the machine. Let me look. The machine has four states. The two pieces of the machine could be ground. They two could be excited, or one excited, one ground, or one ground and one excited. There are four states. But in this interaction, only two of them actually count. Now, let me give them a name to these two combined states. I'm now going to look not at the individual, but at the combined states of the machine, so at the full state of the machine. And I will call this as an excited state and this as a ground state. Why is this excited and that ground? The energy of this is E2. The energy of this is E3. But E2 is larger than E3. So this is like a lower energy state, I call ground, and excited. And the difference in energy between this state and that state is E2 minus E3, which is nothing else than E1. So what I have here, I have one system, my system, that has two states, ground and excited, that interacts with another system with two states, excited and ground, at the same energy level. I will call this system of the two states, I will call them a virtual qubit. So here is now what the machine is. You are used with this machine that has two pieces, a piece in the hot bath, a piece in the cold bath, doing something here and there, and within the machine, you know, transferring energy from one side to the other. But what you see is simply, when you simplify, when you look at the core of it, that the machine is just a two-state system that is put in very simple direct thermal contact with the other. You don't see this when the machine is apparently working and doing, but it is actually very static. It's just something static put in ordinary thermal equilibrium. Like you put an object in a bath of water, ordinary thermal equilibrium, nothing else. Now, I know at what temperature this is. This is at the temperature T1. This is my system. What about this system? It's a virtual qubit. We live at some virtual temperature. And it will have, why does it live at a virtual temperature? You can associate a temperature to any system of two levels, simply by looking at the ratio of population on the excited state and the ground state. And they would have a distribution. You can always write the distribution as being E to the minus E1, which is the difference in energies. And it is indeed E1 we discuss here, because the difference between capital E and ground, which is E2 minus E3, is nothing else than E1. So the energy level here is E1. And then looking at the two distribution, you find a T virtual. And a little bit of algebra tells you immediately what T virtual is, which is a funny number. And I leave it to you to do the tiny algebra. But if you look at this number, you see something interesting. This number, although you calculated it by having two pieces, one at temperature T2, one at T3, is not the average. In fact, it could be smaller than the smallest, larger than the largest. If it is smaller than the smallest, and you put in contact with your system, well, the system will cool because you put it in contact with something that is colder, like your ice cube. If you put it in contact with something that is hotter, well, that is a heat pump, something that takes a system and just increases its temperature by using two baths of much smaller temperature. And what would you like to be the temperature TV if you would like to make here a population inversion? Well, you would like TV to be negative. Okay, so understanding, and this formula simply has everything from minus infinity to plus infinity, depending on exactly what temperature you put and how you couple the two different energies. So let me go now to the final thing. What really is going on? So see, I had here my system, which is in contact with its own environment, a big bath at T1. I have the middle piece, which is in contact with its own environment at T2. I have here the third piece, or the second piece of the machine, in contact with T3. Now, let me look at these two thermal baths. The thermal baths are this beautiful Boltzmannian distribution, e to the minus energy over kT, which is an absolutely beautiful state. Beautiful, but it's boring. It's boring. It's the same ratio between energy levels. But the machine is one piece of the machine that interacts with this bath, another piece of the machine that interacts with that bath. But we just learned I have to look at the machine as a single object. It's a composed object, but it's one single system. Then let me look at the two baths as a composed thing. The baths are not interacting, but they are, you know, it's like two quantum systems that are not interacting, but I could define the energy levels in common with these things. And then you find out that although each of them separately was Boltzmannian, when you look at the energy level of the common system, it's not Boltzmannian at all. There are different energy levels of virtual levels, which are levels of the two baths, at different temperatures. And your machine just interacts with one of these virtual things by design. So what you saw, that the machine puts one hand into one bath, another hand into another bath, it does it by design in such a way that it actually interacts just with some of the two-level systems in the bath that are exactly at the temperature that you want. And then they are in ordinary thermal equilibrium with that. The machine is in ordinary thermal equilibrium with your system, which is in the ordinary thermal equilibrium, well, thermal contact, I would say, not equilibrium, with your environment. So nothing else happens. When you simplify to this level, everything is ordinary thermal contact, like putting bodies of two temperatures. In fact, the external temperature is T virtually, given by the thermal bath with which the machine is in contact and the design of the machine, and the environment of your system. These two are your two temperatures. If T virtual here is smaller than T environment, then because of this thermal contact, we'll lower that state somewhere in between T environment and T virtual. If this is hotter, it will warm that up. If this is negative, we'll produce here inversion. When is the machine the most efficient? This is interesting. The machine is the most efficient when T virtual equals T environment. Otherwise, energy will be dissipated if you put in contact two things at two different temperatures. So, but wait a minute. If I would have a machine that has more levels here, they would be in contact with different other things from the bath, which would have different temperatures. But my system is in contact just with this Boltzmannian thing. So if I have a machine with many levels, that cannot be very efficient. That will never reach Carnot. So originally we thought that the Carnot thing works only when I have an infinite number of states, and if I'm limited in states, I will not be able. Now I realize that, in fact, if I have the machine too many states, I cannot reach Carnot, and it is only the smallest machine that can do it. So how does a macroscopic one that does go towards the Carnot limit? Is because basically it decouples most of its states. And at the end of the day, only acts as a two-level engine. You know, the initial part of the piston, the final part of the range of the piston, and so on. So I will conclude here, but what is interesting in my view is that this gives a completely different approach to thermodynamics. You can now ask all kinds of things. What is the structure of this combined bath? Sometimes I can make a refrigerator by using work, like, you know, that is what all the refrigerators do. But if I use work, I'm depleting levels from this combined bath that are at negative and virtual temperature. But if I only want to use it as a refrigerator, it would be enough to get something that is positive but small. So I'm depleting other things from the bath. It is very interesting. I'm not as efficient as I want. I destroy the bath too much if I convert it into work and then use the work at the refrigerator. There are all kinds of other things that immediately emerge from this. But okay, this was just an introduction to the subject, so thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Questions? So I start with a question, right? So in principle, you can also consider this few-level system in which transition are classical rates, right?
Yes.
I mean, quantum mechanics is not required. So in that case,
yes.
can you have a rate model such that you get the same efficiency as?
Okay, well, so the question was, what about the rate model when I really want to look at all the details, how the transition takes place?
Yeah.
Well, so let me tell you what I did not show here, just to be clear. I did not do this analysis because to see the time evolution, that depends on many, many other factors. That depends on how strong the interaction is between your system and the environment, or between the machine and the environment. And you know that if you, for example, decouple the spiral at the back of the refrigerator from the room, say you put a polystyrene piece of shielding, you'd better run out from there because it will explode, you know, it overheats. So it depends on very many things. And that's a complicated thing. What is interesting, however, is that when you try to ask that some of the questions that you may ask, for example, what is the maximum efficiency, they are independent of the rate. So you may have something that goes faster or smaller, but what is the maximum, that is independent of this.
So you may have a classical few-state system, few-state engine, or a quantum.
I may have a classical one, but what I see, and I don't have time to explain this here, when I try to design it to go towards the Carnot limit, I will see that all the intermediate states decouple, basically. So it's somehow, you know, thermodynamics already knew about some of the things of quantum mechanics, even if it was not obvious. Okay.
Okay. Questions? Paolo?
Yeah. Going back to the beginning, so at the end, in biology, what are the smallest refrigerators?
Okay, yes. Obviously, I was waiting for that question. What happens in biology? Yes, we went back to the biology, and we have a tiny model, which is not quantum, in which indeed an enzyme can cool part of itself. That's a funny thing, if I may take a moment to say. You see, the way in which all biological processes are based on catalysis. Without the fact that we have this procedure that we call catalysis, that is what makes life possible. So imagine that you have, this is really a wonderful background. So imagine you have a molecule here, some molecule, and that is in interaction with other things surrounding it that may come and may hit it, and you hope to arrange for it to break, okay? But the bounds in the molecule are very strong, so there is some rate, but it's not very easy to break it. On the other hand, imagine that this molecule lands on say a piece of metal here. That is like your catalytic converter. Now, what happens is that there are all kinds of atoms here, and atoms in the molecule, they have charges, positive and negatives, and even when it lands, there are some dipole-dipole interactions here, or something more. So that means that the simple fact that the molecule just sits now on something, it is in fact tensed a little bit due to the interaction. It's not a chemical reaction. It's just electrostatic attraction. And that puts a little bit tension and deforms a little bit this thing. And then when it gets hit by other things, well, because it's not in its best state, it breaks easier. And like this, the rate of, say, breaking of a molecule is enhanced when it goes and attaches to something else. That is catalysis, basically. And that happens in all your cars and so on. But if you look here, this molecule, it has some funny shape, and it sits like a potato on the table, and it just touches it in a few points. Now, biology is very interesting. Biology has some very big molecules, These are enzymes, which at a certain place they have a shape like this that is very similar to the thing that you want. All this is a very naive way of telling you what catalysis is, and there are so many interesting things. So sometimes the molecule may come in here. Exactly like a key in a lock. But now there are more forces in between this. So it is more tensed. And now when some external thing come and hit it, it breaks easier. And there are orders of magnitude of enhancing the rate of reaction from here to here, and many more from here to there. Everything works catalytic, okay? And the important thing here is the fact that the shape of this, which is called an active site of the molecule, really matches the shape of the molecule that you want. Okay? But imagine now that there is water around, whatever, at some temperature. And when things are at a given temperature, they oscillate a little bit. So let me take this out from here. So just see here this thing oscillates a little bit. If the temperature is higher, it oscillates more. So let me look at the rate of reaction. So this is temperature, this is the rate of reaction. At the beginning, the rate of the reaction increases. Why? because I have my molecule here that would like to enter. And if everything is colder, everything moves slow. So it takes a long time for this to enter, a long time for this to go. If you increase the temperature, it moves faster. It goes in, it goes out, it goes in, it goes out. The rate of reaction increases. But at a certain temperature, it plummets. Why? Because this thing now moves so much and the active size gets so deformed that it simply cannot enter. And even if it enters, it doesn't fit well. So this is one of the reasons why things are so sensitive in temperature. If your temperature goes about 43, 44, 45 degrees, that's it. So it would be very useful if somehow the enzyme could cool this active site so that it does not get deformed. And the question is, can it do it? Well, that needs to have something active. You know, like a refrigerator, you really need either to pump work into it or to put in connection with two baths. Here I allow to have work. So how can I give energy to this molecule? Well, there are enzymes that also have another active site here in which you can plug a battery. They are not such big active sites. The battery is, you know, there are some universal things like ATP. There are molecules that can give energy into places. So you may have something in which you plug something energetic, and that, for example, may produce a big transformation at this active center far apart. Now, in general, when you squeeze it, then the vibration become faster. So you may have a situation where if I just model this thing like a harmonic oscillator, just say the vibration of this, something like that, and you have some probability being in the lower state, another, and another. Then when you close, you may have this whole thing steeper, so you may excite a lot and so on, but then at the difference of the energy level is bigger, so as you increase it, you will raise its temperature, but because the temperature of the environment is the same T, in the end, it will, if it stays like that for some time, may reach the temperature of the environment, which now means many more molecules here, because the difference to the higher states is smaller. And now comes the thing, but this is not good for me, although, and this is the normal distribution again for that temperature. But now if I open adiabatically slowly, I would reach this thing, the original one, but now with much bigger population now. So there is a mechanism to cool a molecule. Does it exist in nature? I have no idea. This is a theoretical proposal. Give it to a biologist, will tell, this is biology-free thing. Show me that it exists. Well, I don't have a lab, so. Okay, but here is what, a sort of thing that you could play with. So, yeah, that is a possibility. There are other effects in biology which are not related to this, but I told you something coming from thermodynamics. There are many things known for photosynthesis. In photosynthesis, there are experiments that show quantum coherence at a scale much, much larger than you would have ever imagined. So that is a real thing that has been known already for maybe 10 years.
Yeah, just...
Thanks for the interesting talk. I just have a question regarding one of the motivations at the beginning on non-trivial quantum effects. Because from what I understood of the talk, those procedures you described can all be taken into account with classical rate equations of probabilities of what state the system is in. And also the baths are classical heat baths. And the qubits are that I can understand them as classical bits with just two states with probabilities. So I'm wondering whether there are any non-trivial quantum effects involved and how they might affect our discussion of like using classical thermodynamic theory.
Okay, so indeed my talk was very much with a classical flavor. The reality is very far from being classical. So one of the things is that the basic idea was that you may have discrete states, which classically you don't have. If you try to do a real classical model, not a simulation of a system with discrete states, then it will not work. Okay? So already quantum mechanics is from the very beginning embedded in the fact that you have systems with discrete states. This is a highly non-trivial thing. This is, in fact, the whole basis of quantization. Now, that is one thing. Another thing relates that there are many interesting purely quantum effects related here. One of them, well, I've been asked previously, can I look at the rate? And I told you that if I put, for example, a piece of polystyrene in the back of my refrigerator at home, it's not a good idea, okay, because I need to let it cool to the room. So you would think that the best thing classically you could do is to try to, in fact, dissipate easier, to put, for example, you could put it in water or to have more humidity to carry the energy from it. And the more you couple, the better will work. Quantum mechanics doesn't go like that. You run into a Zeno effect. You couple it to the environment and it stops working. So there are many, many purely quantum effects that the moment you start looking more carefully here, you will see them working. Other quantum effects. Well, I have these three pieces, my three systems. Do they get entangled? The question is not very simple, because of course they get entangled, but they will get entangled also with environments around them. And if you just look at my system and the two pieces in the machine, they might very well be non-entangled. Well, it turns out that something, it's interesting here. Whenever you go towards Carnot efficiency, you become non-entangled. You cannot maintain entanglement. And there is an entire space of states that are surrounding the Carnot point that are not entangled. They really must be totally disconnected at the Carnot point. On the other hand, if you want to actually have a machine working, not one that is just doing nothing, and you want to increase the rate, this is one question, you know, to increase the power of the machine, then at a certain moment, this must get entangled. So there are very many things that you can discover on the way. Okay.
There is a question up there.
Yes, please.
Thank you for the enlightenment, Professor. Please, going back to the biological molecule, the enzyme-substrate interaction.
Yes.
I want to know how is the activation energy barrier affected? How is the virtual temperature TV affected by the activation energy barrier? Is there any relationship here?
Whether there is a relationship, yes, for sure. Whether I know it, well, depends on the level of detail. So clearly, the more you increase the temperature, the more this thing gets deformed. Okay. Now, what is the relation between how deformed it is and what is the rate of reaction? Well, you would expect to be something like tunneling. So you would expect things to decrease very fast, to decrease exponentially fast when you are outside of the range, okay? The situation is complicated. I don't want to enter the details. This was an extremely naive thing. If I would tell this to a real biologist, he would laugh me out of the room, okay? First of all, this thing doesn't really need to match the exact form. It would be much better if it would match the desired form after breaking, because that would lower its energy. This is just a cartoon, but you imagine that this molecule here has some positive charges in some location, some negative charges in other locations, and so on, which will want to match with some pattern here. So some parts of these are more sensitive, other parts of these are less sensitive. It is a very complicated system. But one needs to start somewhere. Generally, the fact that the rate of reaction has this form, that is a standard thing.
Yeah, last question, and then we have the diploma.
Hi. Can you give us some insight of what happens when these two pieces of the environment and get entangled and not with the environment?
So what happens then?
Yeah.
Look, I think that what is known at present is the fact that they must get entangled. Okay. One can prove that if they do not get entangled, you cannot achieve a rate higher than something. What is the deep reason for that? I don't think it is clear at the moment, or at least it was not yet absolutely clear some years ago, okay? On the other hand, one can prove that at Carnot they must be unentangled, which again is something very interesting. Entanglement prevents them to reach the Carnot efficiency. I think that much more work in this area is needed to say so, okay? Let me try to zoom out of this question. You know, whenever I don't know an exact answer, I try at least to give a general thing. There has been a lot of work in quantum thermodynamics lately, but that work involved some other questions. They involve the second law and things like this, not the working of the machines themselves. So, and that work is extremely interesting and gives you very interesting connection with information and so on. But I think that one needs to couple that with actually understanding the interaction part of the thing. So those two areas of investigation were not pursued with equal intensity. This one at the moment is more on a back burner, although I believe that it is essential. And to couple that with the advances in the information part of quantum thermodynamics is essential. So that is more or less where the field is.
Okay, so let's thank Professor Popescu.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, sorry, no. Is it okay? Oh.
Can I?
Go ahead, sorry.
Thank you for a very nice talk. I had a question related to what you just said. I mean, the Carnot efficiency normally, then you formulate in terms of entropy and reversible processes, and process where the entropy doesn't change.
Yes.
But which is valid only if you have, it's like a statistical on a large system. So, yeah, is there, yeah, I wanted to ask this, what is the connection with the second law of thermodynamics?
Okay.
And you also mentioned like the fine grain entropy, really the, it's quite different from the coarse grain entropy.
Yes.
And that's related to entanglement. So I just, yeah, you can comment on that.
Indeed. Where should I stand so that he will see me? Or wherever, yes. Well, the idea is, first of all, you saw one example. Well, the final example is how the entropy is conserved. And let me get here. So the basic idea was that I have my system here. This is my system. And here is the thermal machine. And I view the thermal machine as the virtual qubit, just the two states that play, that interact with my system. My system was in interaction with the thermal bath, but the thermal bath had many, many levels. And since it is in interaction with just a thermal bath, you know, it will basically resonantly interact with two levels here, and they are at the temperature of the environment. On the other hand, if I look at the composite bath, which is simply, you know, the direct product of some states of bath, of the hot bath, and some other states of the cold bath. So there are all kinds of levels, but all these levels are at various populations. And some of them are at the same energy difference and couple resonantly, other are not. And the arrangement arranged that what the thermal machine did to couple with something at a virtual temperature. Now, once you did this, all you need is to look at these four things. One system, another, another, another. So what does the Carnot thing do? In the end, you want to couple this temperature with a T environment here. So you forget about everything else. Forget about everything else. And you only have these four things. And as long as they are not at the same temperature, TE, with a virtual temperature, that is generated, then you will lose entropy. Okay. Now, what kind of entropy, if you want to go more into details? Because you are right, now people are talking about many different types of entropy, at least, at least as far as the information is concerned. There are many second laws and so on. So there are all kinds of other details. This particular model of interaction did not look into absolute detail of how, you know, this one gets in fact entangled with many other levels here. And there are events that try to uniformize this bath and so on. So to be able to answer your question, one would need to look in more detail in the actual structure of the bath. So the structure of the bath itself, that is the key element when you want to look at thermodynamics. Whenever we say it is very simple, are just two baths at two different temperatures, that is not enough in order to be able to answer this. It depends very much on the level of degeneracies associated with each of these energies in the bath and so on. So as talking about open questions, I believe that that is one of the very fruitful ways of continuing to ask questions. That is all I can tell at this moment.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so now we can thank Professor Popescu again. Yeah. Thank you for the nice lectures.
Without homo students, okay. So before they leave, everybody here.